On this Sunday, we have a great treat. In Ephesians 4, it says, God has given gifts to the church. Apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastor, teachers, given gifts to the church in order to build up the body of Christ that we might all be fulfilling our ministries for the glory of God. And Pastor John Bogdan is a friend of this church. We met 14 years ago. Seems somehow longer than that at this point, but not so long. But 14 years ago, when one of our first mission teams went to Oradea, Romania, to work with the orphans there, actually, and then somehow somebody introduced us to Pastor John Bogdan, and the rest is history. John Bogdan is not only the pastor of a church in Oradea, Tabor Church, and Ryan Bell referenced that church just a little bit ago. Not only have we had mission trips and served and tried to encourage the pastors there, but we've participated in church planting because John Bogdan has a heart of evangelism. He is a church planter. Most specifically, there is a group of people in Romania called gypsies. They are the outcast of the society. They live out in little villages by themselves. In fact, having driven through San Francisco and Oakland on occasion, I see the, and sometimes you, if you go far enough, you can find them here in Watsonville too, but the homeless that have built like cardboard shacks for their home. That would be similar to the homes of the gypsies. And I'll never forget my visit in 2003, and John Bogdan took me to visit one of the precious families that had come to Christ, and they hosted me in their home, a two-room home. There was no door on the doorway, but just some things hanging down that you had to get through. And they gave me their finest tea that day, and we sat. This was their all living room here, and over here, the other room, that was the bedroom. It was a husband and wife and one boy. And they just honored me, and we sat and shared together, and that was life-changing for me, to sit with these folks whose lives had been changed by Jesus. And John Bogdan and those in Romania are reaching out to these folks and planting churches and seeing the change in people's lives and the change in a culture. So I could go on and on, but I want you to connect the idea that, you know, we're all a part of the Church of Jesus Christ. From 2,000 years ago when Pentecost came and the church was birthed, we're a part of that church all the way through, and we are a part of the church today that is meeting around the globe in the name of Jesus. And you are part of something so great. In fact, let me just tell you, the church is the only thing that's going to last from this world. Now, there's going to be a new heaven and new earth, but the fact is, get used to it, because the people sitting next to you that are brothers and sisters in Christ, you get to spend eternity with them. Good news is there's going to be lots of space so you can get away from them. And that relationship we have with Christ and the relationship we have with each other, that is the relationship. Being in the family of God, it is the ongoing family of God that will rule and reign with Jesus forever. So that's pretty powerful. Having said that, John Bogdan is a great leader in the Church of Jesus Christ today. Would you just join me? He comes every other year or so and speaks at Romanian churches. Do you know there are Romanian churches all across the country? They've immigrated from Romania, and then they've gathered as churches and communities. In fact, John Bogdan was just telling me of one in Portland, a 2,000-member Romanian church that's Assemblies of God. And they gathered together. They came over from Romania, and they identify around Jesus, and then they settle into a community. So he visits all the Romanian churches while he's here, and then sometimes he stops by us English churches, American churches. So at any rate, it would be a great thing if we would just express our appreciation and thank God for men like John Bogdan who are leaders in the Church of Jesus Christ today. So join me in welcoming Pastor John Bogdan.
All the time, Pastor Dennis speaks too nice about me. Lord, forgive him. And I hope, Lord, forgive me because I like it. I'm really enjoy and honored to be with you again. I tell you, even you will not love me or accept me, I will still come to you. I consider you part in my family. And sure, when I talk about Green Valley in Romanian, we have the same feeling like you have here when we talk about Tabor and Oradea and our country. I bring a lot of greetings from your friends from Romania, your sister church in Oradea, Tabor, from my colleagues in Pentecostal Union, pastors, ministers, and from my colleagues, Romanian Pentecostal Missionary Society, the organization that I serve and I work with in a church planting and evangelism. I will tell a little bit more about this, but in the beginning, I like to show you a short video to have the idea and to remember about Romania, what's happened there.
The Lord Jesus has promised in Matthew 16:18, I will build my church. And as we see it, He has been fulfilling that promise. The Great Commission from Matthew 28 that says, "Go and make disciples of all nations," can be understood also as, "Go into the whole world and build my church," because to evangelize, to baptize and to teach means to build the kingdom of God. As an organization, we aimed right from the beginning to take part in this work. As a result, in the years that has just passed, we have had the privilege to enjoy the fruit of our work. We continued through crusades or organized in open air, in tents and in any place we could to enjoy ministering to people.
E o zi măreață, mulți dintre noi sunt cu lacrimi pe față.
As a result of our efforts, we were able to conduct baptismal services for those who received the Lord as their Savior. It was a special moment when, on May 19, 2013, 37 people were baptized in water as a sign of their dedication to the Lord.
Atunci pe nume când ne vei chema, o veșnicie în cer îți vom cânta. Orice pas, Iisus.
With a desire to be faithful in fulfilling the Great Commission, we have not forgotten the ends of the earth. The ministry of Maria and Jonathan Nam was blessed by the souls that were saved and by those who have been helped by their social work, namely the orphanage that they run in a sensitive country which hosts about 60 children. God has also blessed the ministry of Igor Lazar in Moldova and the ministry of the Vasharhei family in the dry land of Kosovo. We continue to build together with the Lord by equipping and promoting ministers. A few days before my coming to the United States, we had the joy to ordain 7 ministers for the work that we do in the communities where we have planted churches. We have also continued to build the church by physical work in constructing churches. During the years, we were able to help more than 100 churches that we were involved in planting to start building sanctuaries. Right now, we are involved in 3 projects of this kind. 1 building is nearly finished and 2 of them are at the beginning. We trust the Lord will help us to continue the work we do. We also very much appreciate your support. May God bless you and reward you for the part you play in building His kingdom.
Probably some of you recognize the voice of my colleague, Pastor Laurențiu Pășcuț. He translates for many of you in Romanian. He helped me to make this video. Another observation, the orchestra who play in the beginning of video, it's orchestra from Tabor Pentecostal Church in Oradea. Probably somewhere there it's Maria Trumpets. Well, she's not here. She's in Mexico now. She left on trumpets, but she have been there. By the way, if somebody has a saxophone, my dear friend Gabi Suchu, the guy who sing with Daniel Bodog, he was in a difficult financial difficulty and he sold his saxophone. If somebody has one at home, I'm ready to take that with me to help my friend. Oh, really? What I want to say after this short video is, as a donkey, I remain perseverant in evangelism, church planting, church construction. I had interesting discussion yesterday night with my friend, Brother Ray, and other families from your church, and we talk about the tendency and the danger to be too human in our work. Yes, people are very important. For people, God sent His Son to die on a cross. But before we work to make comfort for people, most important things is to preach them the gospel and to plant the healthy church. If we have healthy and strong churches, we'll have good social ministry. We have people who work for orphans like your church are doing. We have good schools, etc. My focus, my organization, our church like yours, it's very much oriented evangelism, church planting. Thank you again for your support. Every time when I came here, Every time when you came in Romanian, you bless us. Bless us with your presence. Bless us with your support. And I want to thank you again. God bless you. Well, very brave, Pastor Dennis invited me again to preach. Not easy for me. You saw my English is very different than yours. I don't know where you have been to school. In my school, the English sound different than here. I like to invite my friend Ryan to read the scripture for this morning. It's a book of Isaiah, chapter 6. And because I am Romanian, for this morning, few minutes, I ask you to be Romanians. When Romanians read the scriptures, they stand up. Please do this for the Lord, as a respect for Bible, and a little bit for me. Thank you.
Isaiah 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, and with 2 they covered their feet, and with the 2 they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, and the whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And with my eyes I have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." And he said, "Go and tell this people." Amen.
Thank you. Please take a seat. Book of Isaiah is one of the largest in the Bible. Really, it's a second as a size. The first one is Book of Psalms. Isaiah, it's a second. Because Book of Isaiah has 66 chapters, the Bible commentary makes some interesting comparison with the Bible. Because how you know the Bible has 66 books? Now, the first 39 books in the Bible form together what we call the Old Testament. The first 39 chapters in a book of Isaiah have messages specially for the Israel, for the people in Old Testament. The last 27 books in the Bible form together New Testament. The last 27 chapters in the book of Isaiah have a lot of messages for the people in our time, for New Testament people. The Bible began with human race fall in sin. Book of Isaiah began with describing the sin of the people of Israel. Chronological New Testament began with ministry of the John the Baptist. Chapter 40 from Book of Isaiah relate with first book in the New Testament. It's a prophetic message about the voice who cry in the wild. It's beginning the New Testament time. Lot of many comparison you can make studying the Bible of Isaiah. I told you these things because I want to encourage you to don't consider too long this book and to take serious and God put in your heart the messages of the book of Isaiah. Now I read a portion of verse of chapter 6 in New International and in Romanian Bible is the same title put over this scripture, Isaiah Commission. Really, it's much more than this, than Isaiah Commission. In this scripture, short scripture, you have described the moment when Isaiah met the Lord, saw the Lord. Now, this is the first expression in verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. This is the most important things what's happened in this scripture. Is Isaiah saw the Lord. Isaiah met the Lord. What I want to say in this morning, I like to talk about four things what going on when you see the Lord. When is Isaiah saw the Lord. First one of them is when you see the Lord, when you meet the Lord, when Isaiah saw the Lord, he truly understand who the Lord is. Who is the Lord? That was the moment when he really understand who is the Lord. You know, in 21st century, when we have so many possibilities to communicate with people, we develop a lot of relations. As a pastor, I am in really difficulty when, for example, two young people come to me, boy and girl, telling me they want to marry. And I ask them, from how long time is your relationship? And they told me something like, from 2 years. But when you met first time, and they told me, yesterday. How you ask friends? Oh, by internet, by Facebook. We communicate, but we met yesterday. Not easy for us to decide. We encourage them to marry. We accept them for marriage. You know, in my understanding, probably I'm an old-fashioned man. To know somebody, you have to meet that person. To know God, you have met him. Years ago, I worked in a national railway company, Trent Transportation Railway. And part of my job was to give every morning, very early, 6 o'clock, different reports to my superiors and ministers in Bucharest. Every morning I wake up, I was the first in the company, and I call in Bucharest, talking. And talking with the same people every morning, I make a lot of friends. We help each other. We make different service one to other, but we never met. I remember one interesting experience. After 3 years, I think, of this communication, I need to visit one of that gentlemen what I talk with him every day. I go to Bucharest, and I enter in a huge building of transportation minister, secretary of state, I'll call there, to find that gentleman. Entering that big building, I lost myself, and I find old gentleman, very nice dress, and I ask him, sir, may you tell me where is the office? And he asked me, but what person from that office you want to meet? And I told him the name, and he asked me, but who are you? And I told him, I am John Bogdan from Oradea. And then he made a step back, looking to me, say, hey, punky boy, you are that guy who, for who I tell every morning, good morning, Mr. Bogdan. Well, I was young, 100 pounds younger in that time. His expectation was very different than I look when he met me. My expectation was very different. I couldn't realize, even when I hear his voice, he's that gentleman. Now, something the same it's happened with many people who know a little bit about God. To know God, you have met him. The good news is God is here in this morning. You have a chance to meet him. No? Now, when Isaiah met the Lord, he understand many things. I want to observe in our scripture 3 of them. First one. Again, turn at verse 1, where the Bible say, I saw the Lord seated on the throne, high and exalted in Romanian translation, very high. I want to say that the throne where the Lord stay, it's the over all the thrones. Bible talk about him and say he's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. His throne is over as a position and as a history in time. From eternity to eternity, our Lord is on the throne. I received a very interesting story about Elizabeth II, the Queen of Great Britain. Probably you know she's one of the most longevive monarch in the world. She's the queen probably from 1952. And the story what I receive sounds something like this. When Eisenhower became president of the United States, she was on the throne. When JFK Kennedy became president, she was on the throne. When Johnson became president, she was on the throne. When Richard Nixon became president, she was on the throne. When Gerald Ford became president, she was on the throne. When Jimmy Carter became president, she was on the throne. When Ronald Reagan became president, she was on the throne. Well, with last four or five will be more easy because I drank a cup of coffee with each of them. Who is the next? When George Bush became president, you know what I want to say? When the visible and invisible world have been created, the Lord was on the throne. When Isaiah has the revelation, he was on the throne. When his son, Jesus Christ, came in our Lord to pay with his blood, with his sacrifices, the price of our salvation, he was on the throne. In first, in second world war, he was on the throne. In 9/11, he was on the throne. When the doctor told you, you have a cancer, and your problem is so complicated, he was on the throne. When your son or your daughter gone from home, and you don't know where, he was on the throne. You know what is good news in this morning? He still was on the throne. Never gone from there. He is there for eternity. Praise be his name. Another things what Josiah learned and understood about God, about the Lord, it's he is holy. He is holy. He is holy. You know that it's not only one place in the Bible when we have this picture about worship around the throne. You may open the Bible, book of Revelation chapter 4, where 24 elders, that four living creature, has the same song. Probably if I be in charge to lead the worship around the throne, my song sounds something like, God is good. God is good. He's generous. He's powerful. But the song around the throne of glory is, God is holy. He's holy. You know why? Because his expectation for us is to be holy. Be holy. Bible says, because I am holy. He, God, is holy. Praise be his name. The third things about God, what I say understood, it's his, let me to read the end of verse 1. The train of his robe filled the temple. This is about us. And please make the connection with another scripture from New Testament. Luke chapter 8, verse 44, but to remember the context is their Bible talk about the lady with hemorrhage, bleeding lady. No. This lady, when she understood Jesus will be in the area, she has a desire. You not know what was her desire, to touch him. And Bible said, and I read from Luke 8, verse 44, she came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. He touched the train of his robe. This means for us healing, salvation, grace. It's our chance to touch God, the end of his robe, the train of his robe. Another observation here, the train of his robe filled the temple, the house of God. As a minister, I'm invited many times to pray for sick people, for people with problems, but I'm telling you, I feel much more comfortable when I do this in the house of the Lord. It's message for people. House of the Lord is very important. This place physically is very important. That was the place where God wanted to show his glory and to give his grace for people in the temple, in the house of the Lord. The end of his robe filled the temple. Oh, I pray every time when you come here to feel the grace of the Lord here. His power fill this place and fill our heart, our person, each of us. God bless us. The second thing what Isaiah learned when he met the Lord, he understood who himself is. Who is himself? In my Bible, chapter 6, it's Isaiah chapter 5. Probably is the same in yours. Chapter 5 of Isaiah is full of woes. Let me take some of them. Verse 8, Isaiah chapter 5. Woe to you who add house to house and join field to field till no space is left and you live alone in the land. I think here Isaiah talk about real estate investors. People to add house to house, land to land. I don't know how is the market here now, but in Romania this verse is very truly. A lot of people spend all the money, borrow money to buy land because the price will grow, and how you know everything fall down. And one of them asked me a few weeks ago, give me some money to buy bread for my family. He has a lot of land, but no value, no price for. Woe to people to make that investment, probably. I don't know exactly the sense. Other woe. Verse 11. Woe to those who rise early in the morning to run after their drinks, who stay up late in the night. It's correct? It's correct. Other one, verse 20. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness. Again, it's correct. But something happened in chapter 6. When Isaiah saw the Lord, he turned his watch to himself. And do you remember how Pastor Ryan read? Please look now in verse 5. Woe to me. Woe to me. In chapter 5, you'll find more woes. Woe to everybody. But in chapter 6, looking to himself, he say, woe to me. I am unclean man with unclean lips. And I live in the middle of the people like me. Sinners like me with the same problems like me. Woe to me. And what I want to tell is here begin the repentance. Here. When you sow, you are. You know, our tendency is all the time to compare ourselves with others. And of course, as honest people, we accept we are not the best. Oh, we have our problems, but compare with, I'm good enough. It's a story about two brothers. I think it's an American story. the bad people in the small city, the people who terrorize the city, thief, killers, criminals, capo di tutti capi in mafia, in bad people. And all of them died. And his brother gone to the priest and to talk about funeral and ask him, "Sir, tomorrow will be the funeral of my brother. Here is your check. I like to ask you to tell tomorrow to all the people who will be there, my brother was a holy man." Now the priest was in difficulty. The check one side, the fray in other side, you'll have a problem. And the funeral day came and he began to speak. "Dear family, dear people, how you know that person in a coffin was bad man, was a thief, he was a criminal, but compared to his brother who is here, he was a holy man." We have this tendency to look to others and I consider good enough. When we look to the Lord, we say, like Isaiah, "Woe to me." I pray in this morning the repentant spirit come over the church and to give us this desire to see who really we are, to repent and to see the glory and holiness of God, to see we are sinners. We are people with unclean lips, with unclean hands, with unclean mind. Oh Lord, clean us. Oh Lord, help us to solve our problem. The third thing what Isaiah understood when he saw the Lord is the solution for his sin is to the Lord, is with the Lord. Please look again at verse 6. Is that image when the angel flew to the altar and take a leaf call in his hand and touched the lips of Isaiah. And here is this declaration. "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." The solution for our sin belongs to God. He has only one the solution to solve our problem. And please turn with me in a book of Acts. It's that very famous verse, verse 12 in a Peter message, you know. And he said, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is not another name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." The name, you know how it is the name of Jesus Christ. Is salvation in one only name. Well, what I want to tell you, salvation is not in education. Salvation is not in good things what you can to do. Salvation is not in your reputation or in your diplomas. The problem of salvation have been solved because God sent his son. Weeks ago we celebrate that important moment in history when Son of God came in our world to take away our sin, with his blood he washed, and to receive the salvation, you have to believe in him. You have to repent, because this is only way for salvation. Everything is good. I don't speak against education. We need school. I don't speak against social work. It's very good and it's very important. But we need the grace of God. We need the Bible. We need the power of Holy Spirit to change the people. Here is the problem. Amen. 4 points in my sermon. When Isaiah met the Lord, he heard the voice of the Lord. Verse 8. Then I hear the voice of the Lord. Probably God spoke to Isaiah many times before. And I think Isaiah didn't hear the voice of the Lord. Now, after he met the Lord, he hear his voice. And I want to say it's danger to hear the voice of the Lord. Because all the time in history, his voice has the same message for everyone who are ready to hear his voice. And I ask my friend Ryan to read beginning of the verse 9. He said, go and tell to these people. When you hear the voice of the Lord, you cannot sleep more. Put you on a fire. Move you. 14 years ago, somebody from this church heard the voice of the Lord. And a large group from here came in Romania because they hear the voice of the Lord. When Lord spoke you, he made to let you everything, to spend everything, and go where Lord sent you. I don't know, that visit changed a lot of lives. Ryan talked about his experience. I want to be honest with you. That visit changed my life. That visit changed the lives for 100 people in many communities, Gypsy and Romanian communities in Romania. I will go from here to Mike Smith. In partnership with their church, we built 3 churches in 3 very large communities. That church where we had 37 people for baptism in water is one of that church in Talpos. That is new, probably you didn't visit that. Because years ago, somebody heard the voice of the Lord. I told you it's a danger. Sometimes these things don't let me to sleep. They put you on a fire, send you to build churches, send you to speak, to work, to do something for the Lord. But that moment, it's so important because change the life, change generation, and probably over 100 years, we see the really fruits what we sit in this time. Even in heaven, for us, the heaven will be more interesting. I don't know, it'll be with administration there, probably Peter, no, this Peter, Apostle Peter. I have special request for him to put our churches together because we have so many memories to share with each other. Yesterday night I slept in a Cass family and, well, it's wrong, I didn't sleep. To stay all the night to share, to speak. Because we have experiences in life, we make connection, not for this life, for eternity. I hope Tabor Church in Oradea and Green Valley will be close, to be easy for us to find each other. Now I ask part-time job from Pastor Dennis because I will go to see Bruce, and from there go to see Mike to make this job to look for lost sheep of Green Valley. But the time will come when we'll be together. Oh Lord, keep a seat for each one in your kingdom. And when we'll be together, bless us to be close one to other. Thank you. Really enjoy to meet you again. And if we lost some people, I was so sad when we heard about Johan, about Pastor Copper, about other friends. But for sure, if we stay close to God, in one day we'll meet. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thanks for joining with us today in our streaming of our service and our message. We're grateful that you joined with us. And if we can serve in any way, we'd be glad to do that. Just check out our website. That'll get you connected in any way that you might like to. and that is greenvalleychurch.net. And we wish you the best and know that you really do matter to God. Have a great day.